The roboticist has a touchy job. First-timers have difficulty with it, and this is a point of frustration for many. You're pretty much a doctor with extra access and extra responsibilities, so you need all the skills a doctor needs. Unless you're a traitor, you preferably don't want all your patients dead by the time you're done with them. On paper, you're the station's go-to person for limb reattachments and elective surgeries. Practically, you put brains in cyborg shells, and that's about it. It can get boring really quick if you play this way, though, so you'll have to make your own fun. In any case, I'll give you the full course. This is the robot frame. It's like 80% of the meaning for your existence. Borgs are the perfect workers. They never tire, they need no food, form no unions, and are usually not too murderous. The crew will come to you with people who are either too rotten or too criminal to clone, so you can pop their brain cases open and repurpose their brainular bits into a CPU for a Borg. Now, fair warning. Roboticists are given a bit of leeway with things like non-consensual debutting, but even that's at your own risk. Debraining someone without consent, though, however, falls solidly within the realm of murder, and if you do this, the least you'll have to watch for is the fuzz. More than likely, you'll get boinked. So here's how to put together a robot. First, everything goes on your frame, so throw that out there. Start with the chest piece. It needs some wire and a battery. You'll get audio prompts which will confirm if you've done things right. Then use the chest piece on the frame. The arms and legs can just be put on, but the arms can actually be upgraded if you want. Regular metal will upgrade regular arms to slightly beefier versions, and reinforced metal will upgrade those even more. The head can also be upgraded in this fashion. These upgrades make for a stronger robot, but there are drawbacks for the Borg the heavier you make them. And for you, too. Don't forget, you may not really want a strong robot. If the AI gets subverted, you will have to fight it after all. Legs can't be upgraded, but you can use treads instead, which will make the robot faster. Robots that spawn at round start will have light frames, which generally no robot wants. They're incredibly fragile and easy to break. Eschew these if you can. Now, in order to make the head go onto the frame, it needs some sort of brain. This usually comes from a human or a substitute in the form of an AI interface board, which can be made in one of your fabricators. This allows the AI to control a Borg, which is much more versatile than their little iBots. Either way, once the brain's in the head, it can socket onto the frame. Now comes the most important part, the part everyone forgets. Use a wrench on the frame, and select Activate the Cyborg in order to finish the job. You should know it's done because the Borg's soulless, beady little red eyes will light up. Now, if the Borg doesn't do anything for a long while, they're probably brain dead. That means the person who owns the brain is logged off, or you've accidentally gotten a brain with the Do Not Resuscitate trigger on, or the player who owns the brain is busy somewhere else, like being a ghost drone or a critter. In any case, you don't have to fully disassemble the Borg to try another brain. Simply unlock the chassis with your ID, target the head, and then use a screwdriver to open the brain case. Then remove the brain with an open hand. Now you can slot any other brain in. Make sure to lock up after you're done, otherwise anyone can kill your Borg simply by napping its brain. Borgs can have a variety of options changed when placed into their docking stations. Battery type, repairs, aesthetics, modules, they can all be swapped out here. This is much, much easier than doing it manually, so pray you never have to deal with that rigmarole. The most common requests Borgs will have for you is to change their module. This is a quick fix. Simply pop the module out in the dock. And then slot it into this machine, the module rewriter. From here, you can swap things around to any configuration. Then, place it back into the dock and then install it back into the robot from there. As I mentioned, manual repairs are a lot more complex. The wiki can walk you through these, but I made a little chart that hopefully covers the most common scenarios. The other thing you're going to get requests for sometimes are eyes. Your fabricators can run off the most common sorts, but the first thing to remember is that your fabs don't start out with the requisite materials. Most take this as a death knell, since mining sure as hell isn't going to send them your way, but you can actually get the right stuff out of plain old wire coils. Take some of these, either out of your stash or out of any box containing them, and plug at least two into your portable reclaimer. Click drag from the reclaimer to your nearest fab to get it to output the mats directly into the machine. After you've popped the coils in, set it running. Now you can hopefully make eyes. Most of them, anyhow. Fancier ones will require exotic materials, so if you want anything other than the basics, you're either gonna have to go exploring or get chummy with mining. Straight replacements instead of upgrades are much easier to source. There are usually a few rattling around in the morgue parts bin. Eyes can be extracted from monkeys, and botany can grow them with a bit of effort. Generally, though, eye surgery is such a pain that people who've accidentally blinded themselves will opt to try either oculine or a ProDoc visor, the latter of which can restore eyesight even to those who've deliberately had both eyes removed. Perhaps the most important thing for a new roboticist to learn is the surgical aspect of things. You're technically the go-to person for surgery, so you should really learn all there is to know. And buckle up, because there's a lot to learn. First off's your most common surgery, brain removal. Get your patient and have them prone on a surgical table. Take a scalpel in one hand and a saw in the other. It's helpful to know for this surgery and many others, you can hotkey switch between your active hand with the E key. Now, target the patient's jugular region, and lead in with the scalpel, then the saw, then the scalpel again, then once more with the saw. If all went well, you should have one fresh brain which you can then pop into a robot. Next in order of commonality are limbs. Every now and then you're going to get someone coming in asking for cyborg limbs, or maybe treads. They are probably a traitor. Human bodies can only take light and regular cyber limbs, but in the case of regular ones, you can break cuffs with them. Treads are also great because they immunize you to slipping and make you move at the speed of fast. Still, though, no one visits you otherwise, so you may as well play ball and hope you won't be their first victim. For this surgery and all others, pretty much, you're going to want deep pockets of epinephrine for stabilization, styptic for rapid brute healing, sutures for putting your patient back together again, and an auto-injector of atropine in case you lose control of the situation or get interrupted by someone trying to murder you. It can also be helpful to run off a metabot to serve as your nurse. You can either print one off in your fabricators, or make one from scratch. You can do this by combining an empty medikit with a cyborg arm, a health analyzer, and a proximity sensor. If you're making one from scratch, make sure to use a pen to name your new creation before you add the finishing touch of the proximity sensor. Having a nurse with a name can help to put your patient at ease, building trust. Perhaps the same as before, except you target the relevant limb, be it arm or leg, and then use your tools in the sequence of scalpel, saw, scalpel. Similarly, to tack the new limb on, target the missing part, use your replacement on it, and then follow with the surgical stapler. Eyes, on the other hand, require a new tool, the enucleation spoon. It is every bit as horrifying as you might imagine. Surgery is as simple as before, but you have to make sure you only hold the tools in the same hand as the eye you're taking out. So if you're taking out the right eye, you'll only hold tools in the right hand. Target the head with your spoon, then drop it. Pick up and use your scalpel in the same hand as before, and then use that. Then, back to the spoon. Now you should have one horrific ball of viscera and a patient with half their screen missing. To put an eye into the empty socket, select the right eye socket with your handedness setting, use the eye on the patient's head, and it should pop right in. Next in order of commonality is foreign object removal. You see this more than you think, because every time someone gets shot or stands close to a bomb, they catch a bunch of shrap. Luckily for us, it all goes to the chest. For some reason. Take a scalpel in one hand and a med scanner in the other for this one. Target the chest, and then begin digging with the scalpel. Every time you do this and pop another foreign object out, switch back to the scanner. If it still says foreign object detected, keep digging. Rinse and repeat until your little fleshy bag of grape shot is emptied. Last in terms of common surgeries is butt removal. No one asks for butt removal, but you need them. You need them for your own reasons. Being a physician is lonely, and you need friends. All your surgeries thus far have used the help intent, but for this one you're going to use the harm intent. Many of the more exotic surgeries require use of different intents like this. Anyhow, get onto the harm intent and grab a scalpel and saw. Aim for the chest, and follow the sequence of scalpel, saw, scalpel, saw. Make sure your patient is stabilized, and then make sure they aren't in your office to beat the tar out of you when they wake up, if your deassification was less than consensual. Congrats! You have deprived a farty spaceman of his farts. You monster. The other surgeries are much more rare and esoteric, but the wiki's good for a detailed explanation of each. My main warning to you would be this. Heart surgery is extremely dangerous. No matter how fast you try to swap a heart out, the patient will try their damnedest to bleed out on you. For other surgeries, it's optional, but for this, you should really grab a bag of either blood or saline, hang it on a holder, and tack that onto your surgical bed by click-dragging. Then click-drag this to the patient when you've swapped hearts to begin replenishing the red stuff which they've gotten all over your floor. Careful not to slip. Alright. That is it for surgery. Time for esoterica. Your fabricators kick ass. They have a lot of stuff regular medical fabs have, but a bunch of extra fun stuff too. This includes upgrades for robots, replacement parts, prefab drones, and most notably, both health monitoring and machine translation implants. That last one you're going to want to stick yourself with every round, because the first thing every subverted AI does is to blab to their Borgs to start murdering fleshlings. This'll give you a heads up to either be a hero or take a quick vacation to the biodome. Most interestingly for you, it provides a bunch of other fun stuff when hacked. You don't start with insulated gloves, so do this by finding a vending machine in an out-of-the-way place to find the secret stuff wire on. Which wire does what is randomized each round, but once you've found it, it's the same for every device that uses a four-wire layout. Open the maintenance panel with a screwdriver, and then pulse wires with a multi-tool until you either unlock some secrets or shock yourself. In the case of the latter, at least now you know which wire is the shock wire and you can avoid it. Take this knowledge back to your fabs and hack open the secrets menu to get your prize. Most of these require exotic materials to make, but the most practical object, the Flash, allows you to travel back to the days of yore when roboticists came with these standard because they needed them for making Borg heads. It is a powerful weapon in the search to sate your bottomless burning need
for heirs.
It's also a good starting point for my little shtick on traitor roboticists. You've got your work cut out for you because, frankly, your unique gear sucks. Your syndicate robot frame will produce a loyal helper with a law set tailored to help you out. This is kinda useful, as Borgs can do a lot of things people can't. It's your strongest option, as many hands make quick work, but keep in mind that Borgs are extremely vulnerable in other ways. EMPs will knock them out of the fight very quickly, and they're also very vulnerable to being chain-stunned with flashes. Make sure to beef them up with a bit of metal before you plug that brain in, because your helper's gonna need to take some hits. The big-ticket item is the conversion chamber. It's also the reason I said your unique set isn't too strong. When wrenched into place, this functions as a normal old docking station for Borgs. However, when you shove a human being in, the poor trapped sod will slowly be mangled by a myriad of robotic appendages, transforming them over an agonizingly long 2-minute period into a robot. This isn't as hot of an item as it sounds for a variety of reasons. For one, the board created by this follows the AI law set, so unless you want to immediately be ratted out, you've got to subvert that first, which is usually a tall order. Second, it's both loud and takes a long time. There's almost nowhere on the station you can find that'll put this process out of earshot. And what few places there are so remote that it can make things difficult for you, because you have to get a kicking and screaming human being there without anyone knowing. Third, it's very distinctive. Seldom is there more than one roboticist, and if anyone finds a conversion chamber, that's it. Your only option left is to go loud. This is purely a style option, in my opinion. It's for people for whom regular tradering has gotten too easy, and they want to make things more difficult for themselves. A couple of pointers. You may not be able to escape the chamber from inside, but people outside can free occupants quite easily. Therefore, it's both prudent to make sure your victim has no headset or other means of communication beforehand, and that if someone does happen upon you, you murder them as quickly as you can. Two against one seldom ends well. If you do have another roboticist you can pin your misdeeds on, consider at least putting the chamber somewhere it looks like it belongs. Tech storage, for example, doesn't get visited that often, and few people are going to remember whether or not there's a Borg station in there. Especially because that's the sort of thing that looks like it ought to belong. Generally, though, you want to pick somewhere out of earshot and without much foot traffic. Unless you want to put it in your office, in which case you're a madman who's probably killed half the station already. One thing you've got going for you is that very few people will look twice at you Borging someone, so if you can knock someone out before they can call for help and get them on the table in time, you might get away with killing them that way. If you're the more brash type, you might also rapidly achieve their radio silence in other ways. Roboticist tradering is best done with a healthy basis in regular tradering. Some fundamentals to remember. Never buy your items in a place people can see you. Preferably, buy them off station entirely, somewhere in the debris field. But if you must buy them on station, at least go somewhere out of the way. Second, always lock your PDA after you're done. An unlocked trader PDA is proof positive for the command staff that your body should go in the incinerator. Third, remember that security checkpoints exist. These will scan you for illegal stuff, definitely in your backpack. Not sure about stuff in subcontainers like stealth storage. But security gets notified each time you trip one of these, so be careful. If you're going the subtle route, buy accordingly. Sleepy pens can be emptied and refilled with chems you can either hack out of the medbay vendors or make in virology. Stealth storage can let you conceal incriminating items in an innocuous package that no one will look twice at. Derringers can be hidden in many pieces of gear you wear and drawn out with the wink emote, doing devastating armor-piercing damage, provided you're up close. If you're the louder type, go nuts. Sky's the limit. Darth Vader it up, or embrace the inner weeb you knew you always were. Some economical tips. Dedomatics carts are fairly useless on their own except for harassment, but they can be made viable if you intend to steal a box of PDAs and a box of blank IDs. Using a stolen or fabricated ID, you can register a PDA to the ID you want, keep the ID to make more improvised explosives later, and then use your collection of burner PDAs as small explosives for strategic work. Likewise, syndicate pipe bombs are expensive. You may want to consider learning to make your own explosives, which is both a more economical option and, at the higher end of the explosives knowledge spectrum, much more devastating. In both cases, though, remember that the AI and robots can see through cloaks by default. So if you're going to go the sneaky route, you're either going to have to subvert or kill the AI first. Likewise, the detective starts out with thermals. And a 38, so watch out for that. Well, that's about all for the roboticist. I hope the material wasn't too dry. I'm not sure how complex medical is on other servers, since I mainly stick to Goon, but I know some folks profess a certain degree of difficulty in picking up the ins and outs of it. Hopefully I've remembered to link those little cheat sheets I made in the description below this video, but if they aren't there quite yet, I'm probably just faffing about with how to host them, since I'm more or less technologically illiterate for someone my age. At least I think I fixed the sound issues on this one, so hopefully people with surround or headsets won't be bleeding out the ears this time. Been thinking about what to do the next segment on. Bit divided on that one. Maybe science, but that'd likely be so big it'd have to be cut into smaller episodes on each subdepartment. In any case, I hope things are going well on your end. I know we can't spend all our time in space, and from time to time that feels like a real shame. Personally, we've been getting a bit of volcanic fog in my neck of the woods, which is always fun for someone with finicky lungs. Till next time, this is Kawakji, signing off.